Mark Kemp with Acoustic Guitar Magazine, and today we have in the studio Seth Avett of the Avett Brothers. Seth, great to have you here.
Thank you so much. Appreciate you having me.
Let's talk a little bit about Souls Like the Wheels, which is a song that you guys put on your most recent album, Magpie,
yeah.
A live version of it,
yeah.
But it has a longer history than that. I understand that you're doing a different or an older arrangement of it.
Yeah, here today, doing the original arrangement in this open tuning, but live I've only done it that one time. The version that's on the record is the only time it's ever been done live.
Oh, wow.
In that way, and after the record came out, we worked up a full band, all seven of us on stage, more up tempo. More sort of shuffling, kind of faster arrangement. That's just a little bit more fun to play, a little more celebratory to play live. But yeah, this is the original quiet sitting in your bedroom version.
Souls like the wheels, turning, taking us with wind at our heels, burning, making us decide on what we're giving. Change this way of living. One little song. Give me strength to leave the sad and the wrong, buried safely in the past where I've been living. Alive but unforgiving. Let me go, let me go, let me go, let me go. One little girl, bring me light from where I thought it was dark. Be the spark that has a chance to light a candle. Love that I can handle. Let me go, let me go. 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 Souls like the wings, spreading out away from bad memories, make us capable of taking off and landing. Alive with understanding. standing. Let me go, let me go, let me go, let me go. Let me go, let me go, let me go.
And how did this song come about?
I think it was one. It's old enough now. It's old enough to where I have to think, you know, and try to remember exactly where it came from. But it's clearly coming from one of those times in my life that were like a rebuilding. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. I think I'm learning anyway that I think when I was working on that song, I thought that it was the rebuilding time of my life, but there's been a good two or three major ones since then. So I think that I don't know, you probably can, the older you get, look back on your life and pinpoint, okay, that was a major turning point or breaking down and rebuilding. And then, you know, so many years later there was a breaking down and a rebuilding, and I guess it can come from whatever, a heartbreak or a death or a marriage or a divorce or whatever, like all kinds of things sort of like reset you. And I think it's just one of those resetting times when I was looking to get on to the next chapter. Mm-hmm. And it's sort of a recovery song and also like a plea, sort of let me go, kind of hoping that all the elements around you can fall in line with your desire to move forward.
Do you think about what tuning you're going to use when you're writing a song? Like, you know, that's an alternate tuning. Do you go, wow, this is, I'm having a drop D day today?
Yeah, or? I don't know. Yeah, like that tuning is sort of my boneheaded version of an open tuning. Instead of, very typical of me, instead of going out and learning, like reading up on available open tunings, mm-hmm. I just went at it in the most black and white way, which is tuning the guitar as if I was playing a D and then dropping the top string. So, you know, and I learned very quickly that there's just something so attractive to me to how harmonious it is to just be able to not even fret the guitar and to do that. And but you know, it is a little bit constricting in terms of what you can do, like right, versus a standard tuning, but I sort of created all my own chordings, and I've written quite a few songs in that tuning, but I don't plan anything like that. That's just something that just I like an idea normally comes out of something getting shaken up. Not in a big way, a small way, maybe like picking up a guitar I've never played before, or putting the capo in a different place, or putting new strings on the guitar, or sitting on a different chair or whatever. But there aren't things that I really plan. They just kind of happen.
Seth and I come from the same area of North Carolina, and I've watched you guys grow. I think the first time I saw you, Dolph said, come out to the Wachovia Atrium. I got this band I want you to see. And the Avett brothers were out in the middle of Charlotte, North Carolina, playing their music for all the bankers that are there.
Yeah. And there's a ton of them.
And there's a ton of them. And it was just such an awesome sight to see these, like, really dressed up, you know, guys watching these ragged
blue-collar country boys. Yeah,
you've come a long, long way since then. Yeah. You know, and everybody's kind of watched you grow. What does it feel like to go from that place, you know, where you're kind of, you know, you're a big band in a small town, basically, to playing arenas?
I think that we might be the ultimate example of, at least in our own perspective, the ultimate example of a gradual build. So, I was actually riding in the car with my cousin, who's also a good friend, and she was asking, like, you know, whenever you walk out on the stage and there's all these thousands of people, do you ever just go, wow, like, look at this, I can't believe this? And I was like, not often, not necessarily. It's not that it's not a big deal for me, But it's like whatever is your, what's your norm? Like what, like bigger crowds now, very fortunately for us, has become a part of our normal environment, right? Yeah. So much like a person might take a husband for granted or a wife for granted, you know, you walk into the house and you've been married to him for 20 years and you don't think, wow, look at you. You're amazing. You're this amazing person that I get to be with. Like every day I get to see you. But like, if you really checked in, you probably would do that.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Uh-huh. And so, you know, just like the use of my hands or a loved one, a significant other or a family member, I take it for granted often. And I have grown into I've grown into the shoes of a performer and entertainer that's used to stepping out in front of thousands of people.
Mm-hmm.
So if you would have asked me, if you would have plucked me up from the Wachovia Bank atrium and you know set me on the Red Rock stage, you know, with 9,000 people in front of me, I would have answered the question very differently. But you know, we've been afforded the space and the chance and the time to do, you know, a good, whatever, 4,000 or 5,000 shows, you right. know, to get to that point. So I don't think on it much. And we've also sort of trained ourselves to think of things in very small segments.
Right.
Much like an alcoholic would, you know, the take it one day at a time kind of thing. That,
right.
That seems, in our mind, that applies to really to life all the way.
It does.
All the way around. So try to leave the stuff that's not available to us alone. And like today we're playing, you know, we're playing in Berkeley, you know, but I haven't even gotten there yet. Like I'm here. Like we're gonna sit down and talk about guitar and about songs and about the band and that's where I am. So